The Philippine government and the Moro Islamic Liberation Front are committed to finish before the new year annexes to the drafting of the Bangsamoro Basic Law. Here's a look.
Just over a week since President Aquino signed Executive Order 120 creating the Bangsamoro Transition Commission on December 17, both sides have begun selecting nominees to the 15-man body tasked to craft the basic law for the Bangsamoro government. 8 members will be selected by the MILF, 7 by the government side from different sectors of the Bangsamoro people. MILF Secretariat Chairman Muhammad Amin said the MILF is very strict in its selection process, with each nominee having to show loyalty and dedication to the Bangsamoro cause. Maguindanao Governor Ismael Maguindanao endorsed 2 respected lawyers, Suharto Ambulodto, former election supervisor in Maguindanao, and Maguindanao 2nd District Representative Simeon Datumanong for the government side. Both the Philippine government and the MILF have been urged not to appoint traditional politicians, which the framework agreement seeks to replace. Government Peace Panel Chair Miriam Coronel Ferrer said the tasks of the Transition Commission are separate from the process involving the crafting of the comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro, and any delays in the drafting of annexes will not have a significant impact on the peace process. Both sides are confident annexes to the framework agreement will be completed before the end of the year.
Journey for peace and development in the Bangsamoro.
Joining us on Hot Copy, Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process, Secretary Ging Deles is with us this morning. Good day to you, Secretary. Thank you for coming to the show. All right, first and foremost, who took over SC Justice Marvick Leonen's job?
The president appointed Miriam Coronel Ferrer, better known as IE, who has been a member of the panel since the beginning under this administration. She's a long-term peace advocate, worked in civil society, was part of the academe, had done a lot of the studies, advocacies on the peace process, and was really the mainstay of Justice Leonen during this period.
So. What will be her formal title?
She'll be the chair, panel chairperson.
Panel chair.
She was a member, now she's the panel chair.
Okay, all right. Now, just very recently, let's start with that. The president signed Executive Order 120, creating the Transition Commission.
Right.
Where are we with that now?
Well, the Transition Commission is the first political commitment to be delivered under the framework agreement. So this now establishes the legal basis for setting up the Transition Commission. Both sides are now, as I understand it, also the MILF and definitely on our side, going through the names of applicants and nominees to have a short list, on our part, a short list to give to the president, hopefully for appointment by early January.
And now it's 15 people in the Transition Commission.
15 people, 8 to be named by the MILF, but still to be appointed by the president, and 7 on the side of government.
Okay. So now why does the MILF get more people?
Well, the Transition Commission will be drafting the basic law, and they had negotiated this, the continuity in terms of the agreement would be there, and we agreed that they have one more than us, including the chair.
Okay. All right. Put some water first. Now, just recently, I think the government had committed that the annexes would be finished by the end of the year. Is that possible?
Well, that was part of the framework agreement. It says that before the end of the year. The reality is a lot of work was done, many agreements, but there are still some issues that we need to go back to our principles for and need to work out. They decided during the last meeting in November that there would be have to be some consultations with experts. So I think we are looking at completing in January.
Okay. All right. So when the president appoints the members of the Transition Commission the Transition Committee or Commission?
Commission.
Commission in January. So the commission will start to draft the basic law.
Yes.
Okay.
Of course, you can understand that there will be some organizational work first, because
yes.
This is going to be a new organization. They have to set up office. They have to bring in staff, and and all of that. So while the annexes are being completed, the Transition Commission setting up its office and really starting even its work and its consultations will also begin.
Okay. So what are some misconceptions when it comes to when people perceive a basic law? Like some I've read is there could be a change of citizenship.
Oh, no, no. That is very clear in the framework agreement. It's Filipino citizenship, Bangsamoro identity. Yes. And that identity is not really such a strange thing, you know. We all carry our identity. Some people have very strong ethnic identity, religious identity, and we recognize Bangsamoro as a political identity.
Okay, all right. Let me go to a quick break so I can get you a glass of water. We'll be right back. All right, so clearly there is no change in the citizenship. It's the Filipino citizenship, but the Bangsamoro identity. Just a quick break. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back to Hot Copy. With us is Presidential Advisor on the Peace Process. Secretary Ging Delis is with us. We're talking about the crafting of the basic law and the misconception. So the first one is they will retain a Filipino citizenship but Bangsamoro identity. Yes. Now, ma'am, can they make recommendations to change the Constitution?
Oh, yes, just like anyone else, you know. The Constitution itself says that it can be changed through certain processes. So anyone can propose that. It will have to go through the legal process, which is either, through Congress or through People's Initiative.
Now, what do you think, okay, should we expect that the basic law, among the most basic terms, will contain? I'm sure that you already have an inkling with all these months of speaking with them.
Well, one of the ones, and that is in the framework agreement, is that the form of government in the Bangsamoro will be ministerial.
Okay.
So that it will be different from the rest of the country where we directly elect the governor. This one, the people will elect the assembly, and the assembly will elect the one that will be called the chief minister. So instead of having the regional governor as we have now, directly elected by the people, there will be a chief minister elected by the assembly who are elected by the people. So that is still within the Constitution.
All right. Now, my question is, why do they want that? Does that make that any more efficient? I mean, it is different than the rest of the country, but how does that benefit them?
Well, they were the ones who asked for this. I think one of the reasons is that it is closer to the Islamic consultative Shura. On our part, we thought maybe it will make for a more accountable government instead of the governor that has been seen historically as having been chosen by Malacañang.
That's true, who's become a puppet.
Yes, endorsed by Malacañang and looks to Malacañang for the support even if the people don't like him or her anymore. This time the chief minister will have to be accountable to the assembly because the assembly can change him or her.
Now, will the chief minister it's not, of course he's a minister, but it's not ministerial in function alone. He will hold money. What a governor does?
He will have a and then he will have a cabinet. It is like what operates that the governor does. Now, there will be the cabinet will also come from the ones elected. And they will have all of the functions. The bureaucracy will still be in place.
Okay.
The exact form of the more specific elements will still be decided.
Okay. The areas that will be covered by the Bangsamoro region in 2016, if they have an assembly, paano yung secretary? Meron pa ba silang councilor? Meron pa ba silang mayor, vice mayor? May tatakbo pa bang ganun?
Yung local government remains the same.
Okay.
The local government remains the same. It is the regional government that is changed, the form of the regional government.
Now, how many people do you think will be in the assembly? Of course, you will discuss this, but more or less.
Well, there will be district representatives. No, just like now, there are three per district, but they can in such a form decide to have some sectoral representatives.
But will they still have a congressman? Will that stay?
Yes, in the national government.
Okay.
So they will still be represented in the national government with Congress, hopefully also be able to elect members to the Senate.
Uh-oh.
So that there will be members of the represent, there will be Bangsamoro residents who are elected to the Senate.
Uh-oh.
So all of that stays the same.
But
the representation in the national is the same, the local government is the same.
But my question is, the congressmen who are from the Bangsamoro region, should they be part of the assembly?
No.
Are they not?
No, they will be still directly voted as part of national elections.
Uh-oh.
So as we said, they are still part of the Philippine. And there's Filipino citizenship. So they are still participating in national government as well.
Okay. So the Bangsamoro Assembly will consist of how many? Are we talking 15 or 30 members?
Probably more.
All right. Like 100 plus?
Well, right now there are 5 provinces with several districts. I think right now there are about 25.
Districts?
More or less. No, members. There are 3 per district. There are 5 provinces. If there are some additional areas that will decide to be part of it, such as Isabela City and Cotabato City are named to be asked whether they want to be part of it, then that would be additional. They could also do, as I said, as happens in some other parts of the world. And even in our national Congress, there are sectoral, party lists. Or sectoral representatives that can be added on.
Now, aren't we adding just more red tape? I mean, essentially what you're adding is the governor becomes the chief minister, but we're adding an assembly of more people, which means papasweldoan rin yun ang gobyerno.
Well, ngayon naman meron ng assembly.
Meron na.
You have the regional legislative assembly, but you have just like it is in the national government, the executive branch is separate from the legislative branch. In the ministerial form, this will all come from the same elected body.
Okay.
So basically, that's the same. You will have the same people. We just don't know whether the numbers will stay the same. Maybe one thing that, in fact, will lessen the number of people is that the cabinet will come from the assembly.
Okay.
Right now, you have a cabinet appointed outside of the assembly.
Yeah, better yun, from within the assembly.
From within the assembly. So dapat elected
rin sila. So at least streamlined din.
Yun, ganun. Ganun yun. So, what we are looking at, and what was put before us when they made the proposal, we thought that it may be a way to go to begin to look at this system that that they will see that, you know, the chief minister has to be accountable to the assembly and the assembly is elected by the people instead of always looking to the center of government, which is Malacañang.
Okay. Now, will they have their own police force?
We follow the constitution. There is one national police civilian in character. So, but we are looking at what are the powers? What are the powers that may be shared in terms of the police? But that it is very clear. There's only going to be one national police. This is still one of the areas needing more discussion in the annexes on normalization. But we agree, as it is in the framework agreement, that the police needs to be strengthened. It needs to be reformed. It will be fully taking over all law enforcement functions. Right now, they get a lot of assistance from the armed forces of the Philippines, which more properly should be more really focused on external defense.
Yeah. Okay. May budget na itong transition commission of 100 million.
That's right.
Okay. So with 2016, that's 3 years from now. Before 2016, dapat matapos ang basic law.
Dapat matapos.
Alam naman, hindi na presidente si Pangulong Aquino, hindi pa tapos yan.
That is very clear in the framework agreement that because this law will have to go to Congress and be enacted by Congress.
Okay.
So that really, I think they will want to be bringing it to Congress by 2014.
So you have a year. You're giving yourselves a year.
Yes. Maybe we can say at the latest, by 2015 it should have been passed because it will need to be ratified by the residents and the residents of the areas that were identified are given the chance to say yes, we want to be part of this. So that in 2016, elections will happen already under the new form of government.
Okay. So will they have elections for the assembly sabay with the 2016 national elections?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, my God, that's a lot of people to vote for.
Yes, if you live there.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yes.
Diba, you vote for councillors, mayor, vice. Then you vote for, let's say, 30 people of the assembly, or you only vote for your
representative. For your district, yes.
Okay, not that bad.
So an additional, I don't know, maybe 3 or 2.
Okay.
And, yes, but, you know, the president already decided early in the term that elections of the arm should be synchronized with national elections. So, yes, in 2016.
Okay.
That is the deadline.
All right. Now, one of the most contentious issues is the decommissioning of firearms. Now, the MILF was interviewed at a Malaysian news agency, Bername, and the MILF chairman said that they will only start dropping their guns once the appropriate political conditions for it are established. What does this mean?
Well, I think, and it is put in the framework agreement, that decommissioning will be phased and calibrated.
Okay.
Our understanding and this is under discussion is that it will start as political commitments are delivered.
But there's already one. Transition Commission.
Yes, so
is a political commitment.
That is a political commitment. So we are holding on to that. And when the Transition Commission, as this goes. The discussion then is how do you begin that process? Where do you begin? And all of that is under discussion. We agree that completion, substantial decommissioning happens when the law is delivered.
Okay, so wait, but are you estimating how many firearms does the MILF have? I heard 11,000.
Well, 11,000 is the number of the AFP in terms of the armed, of the armed militia. So,
but you put it to 15.
For our firearms.
For an estimate. So when it comes to 15,000 firearms, for example, yung phase na yun, ma'am, like when you start the transition commission, wala bang may start na 2,000 surrender?
You know, there are different ways of looking at phasing because, you know, they have what you can say base commands in different parts of Mindanao, some outside the arm. So one could start there, or one could talk about what kinds of arms, kinds of weapons. You know, a handgun is very different from a mortar.
Yes, and a high-powered rifle.
Yes, so what it can do.
Correct,
so,
I agree.
So that could be that the level of discussion. What should be decommissioned first?
Well, but will they be transparent to the government of what they actually have?
That's why they have there's a third party. There's a third party that observes this internationally.
Yeah.
That is what has happened.
Yes.
The third party may have some international component. That is how it has worked in other parts of the country. Because I mean, how on their part they.
Would I want to reveal everything
have? Yes, because this isn't finished yet.
Mm-hmm.
And on our part, are you telling
us
the truth? So that is why third-party monitors are mentioned in the framework agreement.
Okay. Now, very interesting. I will read this. The MILF chair had said that an MILF company commander, Abdul Sharif, had said that the members are divided over the laying down of firearms. So I believe that in the second phase of the peace talks, this is one of the most crucial, the laying down. And the timetable has not yet been finalized.
Not yet finalized, but there are proposals on the table. But I think people should understand that for a movement that has been fighting for so long, that when you talk about normalization and the decommissioning part in particular, is that people will have some different perspectives here.
Mm.
And part of it is on our part, and this is also mentioned in the framework agreement, is also being able to assure fighters that there is a life beyond fighting.
Tama. You know?
So that is also part of the discussion. What alternatives do you offer then? And what we're hoping is that as the fighters see more of this on the ground, that actually the peace is real.
Yes.
The land can be cultivated. There is livelihood that's coming in. My children can go to school. Health centers will be set up. All in discussion with the MILF. is that people will see, ah, it's not just a matter of me giving up something, but that I actually will also get something for a more...
Or better.
Better, yes. I will get something better for a normal life, for a future, for my children. So this is something that I think we should expect that there will be some skepticism here on both sides. Will this really happen? But the truth is, in other parts of the world, it has happened, not so smoothly.
Yeah, you have the Belfast Agreement.
Yes, and you have people who are holding off up to the end. But if the bulk of the fighters and the leadership, as we see the MILF, is committed to this, then this is really something that we should all hope for and pray for and work on.
Okay. Now, is there any penalty in the framework agreement if the panel discovers that the MILF is buying more arms?
Well, that will be raised. Right now, we still have the international monitoring team. And as we know, there are a lot of international observers here, many friends of the process. Definitely, I think the friends of the process, both international and local, are looking at both sides. Are they sincere? Are they on the right track? The ang batuwid ba ito? And certainly, this will be a matter of grave concern.
Mm-mm. Now, we know that worldwide, this administration has gotten the most praise for actually having the Bangsamoro Peace Agreement. Sabi nga nila, when there's peace, there's actually development. So that's the best thing for the region. What do you see as the biggest hurdles that you have to face, the panel, to making this actually push through and successful?
Well, there are still difficult issues in terms of the annexes, the details.
Of course, one would be the decommissioning of arms. Ano pa, ma'am? Wealth sharing.
There are still some questions there. There are still some questions. I can only reveal so much, Karen, you'll understand, because we don't want to negotiate openly.
TV. But the wealth sharing, more or less, there was a, correct me if I'm wrong, but what came out in the news is they had wanted, was it 70% of all revenues from the area theirs and 30% going to the national government?
The issue was on the sharing of revenues from natural resources. I think we have a formula there that is acceptable.
Okay. Can you
acceptable.
Share the formula?
No. I'm sorry.
Secret formula.
I'm sorry. But the consultations are being done.
Okay.
But it's not for me to reveal.
Okay.
At this point.
Okay. So we're getting somewhere. You have the wealth sharing for natural resources, but another contentious issue. No one's been writing about it, but I feel it's major. The logging. Isipin mo, naka-total log ban tayo, ha? Mm-hmm. The president has ordered a total log ban, and yet the DENR catches the most illegal logs in that area. So it means nobody there is cooperating.
Well, even now, the ARM governor knows that is one of the mandates. So definitely environmental standards.
Yeah, but the MILF is included. I mean, suspected of being part of those that have been trafficking the illegal logs.
Well, that is
will that be discussed?
Environmental standards, the sharing of powers in terms of handling the
but sana
the
logging
resources.
Specifically.
May
parang dapat may isolated ano siya, ma'am.
Well, I will diba? Relay that. but what I'm saying is we cannot wait till 2014 or 2015 to face this.
Tama.
What should be done now? In fact, the current ARM government knows that is on its plate right now. So the president is very, very very strong on this. I think all of the natural upheavals that are happening are pointing to that. We will not wait for the basic law to set that. To fix that up.
All right, questions from our viewers for you. Arceo James Honculada asks, what are the possible risks that will make this peace framework fail for ARMM or the Bangsamoro areas? Very good question.
Well,
what can make it fail?
Well, I think failure will be a failure of will of the leadership of both sides.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, what I see, what we see, is the strong will of the president and the strong will of the MILF leadership, mm-hmm. Will there be challenges along the way? We can expect that. I think there is no peace process that sailed smoothly.
Yeah.
Even the famous Good Friday Agreement.
Yes, 30 years.
Yes, and they set up, there is the real IRA that was set up. But as you can see, life has changed in the area.
Yeah.
By and large, the agreement pieces in place, so we should expect challenges,
yes.
And that is why we continue to ask people to support this process. It is not going to be smooth sailing, but the will of the people, embodied in the will of the leadership of the president and the leadership of the MILF, I think we can be able to meet whatever challenges put in front of us.
But what's very interesting, I had Lord Trimble on the show, and he had said what surprised him was, unlike in their areas, no, in Ireland, they were just talking about hundreds of guns. Dito, he's so shocked that it's thousands of guns. So in terms of smuggling in firearms, do you see that as a possible problem? A hindrance to actually?
You know, over the last years, we've been checking on that, because every time you hear a report, we have our AFP, our intel, check that out, and so far there has been no validated measure. I think what we are also looking at is in this area, and that is why there is such high international support for this, is people really want peace, and they know that arms trafficking,
trade,
is there, and they don't want those guns entering into their area, so they are also very concerned that our southern borders do not become porous in terms of guns. So I think everyone is watching that. I think it is, you will see a difference in terms of the international in the international context, where before there may have been some countries or states that supported war in other places. I think there is, you don't have that. You don't have that now. Everyone has their own problems.
Yeah.
I think that's one.
Now, one of the controversial aspects, we hear it every time. Every time in the past, where the military enters a particular area, where there was even a debate. I can't remember this exactly right now, but the military, of course, had said many times, kapag naman kasi may encounter, ang MILF at Abu Sayyaf, iisa lang yan. Mm-hmm. Ang MILF rin mismo daw ang kumukupkup sa Abu Sayyaf, giving them a place to stay. Is this also tackled in the framework agreement?
In fact, you can say that the peace process has in fact brought the MILF to constantly work on this problem. Right now, we have the mechanism, the AJAG, the Ad Hoc Joint Action Group, whereby the commitment is for the MILF to help
in the
interdiction of lawless elements in their areas, and that has happened already.
Paano kung kamag-anak nila?
There are ways of helping.
There are ways of helping. All right.
There are ways
of helping. James again is asking you, has the panel considered the presence of family feuds or rido? Ganda ng tanong ha. Taga Mindanao siguro to. Between rich families that results to armed conflict. Good question.
No, definitely, and we have always said, and I think the MILF agrees that is going to be the challenge for any government in the arm and for the Bangsamoro.
Kasi armed rin yun.
Yes,
and
that is why when we talk about normalization, and this is the particular challenge here, we're not talking just about the arms of the MILF. You have to talk about the arms of everyone else.
I agree.
So
even
that,
residents there have arms.
So that, well, not,
oh,
not,
but you say
better not, better not just there naman.
Oh, in Jolo is one, but well, that's not part of the region.
No, it is. It is.
I part yun ang Jolo.
Yes, Sulu.
Okay.
Sulu is part of it. But I just wanted to say, but other parts of the country also have that problem. But yes, it is a problem. It is a problem there. So that is why, that is part of the normalization. You will have to be looking at how can you ask this group to completely disarm if other groups around them.
Very good.
Some of whom there may have be some family feuds.
Tama.
Still have
Tama.
There. So this is going to be, and I think this is what we look forward to. It is going to be a real partnership between the government, the MILF, and other governance constituencies in the region, to look into this matter and really try to look at what is a life where everyone will feel secure, be able to trust the state forces to keep them secure, and be more engaged in other productive activities to take away the the pressure to keep on fighting, whether it be for this, whether the cause of the MILF is covered or the causes of their families fighting other families.
Okay, just a quick question before we go to this question is, let's say may nagnakaw ng ano, ng pera sa banko doon, in a Bangsamoro region, o wag naman ganun ka-severe, pero may nagnakaw, which court does he go to? Does he go to the municipal court or does he go to the Sharia court?
Sharia is for personal law,
okay.
Only between Bangsamoro.
And two so people, both sides, Bangsamoro, dalawa.
Bangsamoro,
okay.
Pareho. And personal law. Personal law. Personal law, that's largely family.
So, kalimbawa, what if ninakawan ko ang gobyerno. Muslim? Hindi naman, yung kapitbahay ko. Pero Muslim siya, saan yun?
Hindi ko alam kung personal law yan.
Oh, dahil na, diba?
But depending on, yes, well, the lawyers, that's clearer already. I'm not an expert on Sharia law, but definitely personal law, so that's mainly family and such relations.
Uh-oh.
But otherwise, the legal system that exists in other parts is still going to be there as
so
well.
So let's say nakapatay ang isang Muslim sa Bangsamoro region, ang kapwa Muslim. Kasi kung, alimbawa, Kristiyano yun, that's clear that's gonna be in the regular court. Punta dun yung, Kristiyano, paano po kung Muslim napatay niya?
Well, depende siguro sa context. No?
Oo, depende. But yun ang mga, parang that's a very gray. Kasi, do they have death in Sharia?
There are some standards that are set already.
Oh, no death.
That are going to be followed.
Very good.
No
so bawal maputoy ng daliri. No, I'm kidding. Of course. But I'm curious. Yeah. You have to go to all these.
Yeah.
No.
But in terms of Sharia, I don't know all the answers. But there are legal experts there already at work. So some of the questions you maybe you are asking,
they will be people
who know. Unfortunately, I'm not a lawyer of any kind.
But I'm just so amazed, Secretary. The massiveness of actually making the basic law, it's not as simple as what people think, diba? Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Because there's a whole complexity to the culture, the faith, diba, ma'am?
Well, yes, and that is why the recognition of the need for an autonomous region precisely is a recognition of a distinct history, a distinct culture, and that governance needs to be closer to what people can really feel on the ground, and that is going to be the attempt here. But let me say, there is in fact already a Sharia law.
No.
That is why there is Sharia.
But do they practice blood money? The of blood money?
I have not, I've not been
Me also,
that.
I'm not familiar. But because most Muslim countries, they do practice blood money. Now, another question, why is it that private armies are still present in Maguindanao and Lanao del Sur?
Well, maybe
hirap naman na tanong yan talaga.
That is one of the ongoing efforts of the PNP.
Uh-oh.
That is one of its mandates. But when you ask this question, the reality is there may be private armies also in other parts of the country. It is a problem.
But bigger there.
Well, maybe. But we have had very big private army problems, if you will remember ABRA for a while.
Of course,
was practically, so
run by a private
army. So I just want to move away from this dito lang sa sa Bangsamoro ang may problema na ganyan. But it is a real problem. It is one of the things that will need to be sorted out.
Okay. Quick last question from Jeub. How true is it that the GRP can opt out on certain clauses of the agreement anytime, but the MILF can't?
Well, that's not true. The president's mantra is don't sign anything that we cannot deliver, or we will deliver everything that we sign. I think that's why if you will read it, you will see all the qualifiers there that are already put into place.
Okay.
Which in our light is our safeguards. That we don't do things that we are not allowed to do, for one, which is well understood by the MILF.
Yeah.
No, we cannot opt out, and we have no intention of opting out of any clause.
We've gone this far.
We have. This was all thoroughly discussed. All of government is behind this. And that is why the annexes, the details, is more hard work, because as you go into that, the president's instructions remain the same. We cannot commit to anything that is not within our power to do.
And very good.
And it is not just it's delivering in all ways, politically, economically, culturally, and of course legally. That will have we work by that, and we are confident that the framework agreement, as carefully crafted as that had been, will be able to pass the test. We can deliver on this.
All right. Well, good luck. And frankly, I think everybody wants this to succeed. You have everybody batting for its success. So best of luck for the government and the MILF. But more than anything, a lot of work on your hands come 2013. Secretary
right.
Dennis, thank you
That's
for coming. Right. Let's get started today. I'm Karen Davila. Replay of this interview is at 6 p.m. tonight and 4:30 a.m. tomorrow. I'll see you again. Tomorrow is Friday. Take care, everyone.